Okay, so Tami Leo now is going to deliver his talk, coupling of a singular layer for Boltzmann equations. So please, Tami.
Thank you, Piero. I met Piero in the 80s, and he organized a huge conference. And he actually went to airport to pick up Joe Smoller, Ron DiPerno, some of you know. And I, and it was such a success. Later on, I asked him, how did you do it? You know, there are many layers of difficulty you can imagine. And he was very, very young. He's young, but was younger then, okay? And and he said that, well, I asked people, because the shock wave theory was not a new field to him. He was not even, can be said it's new, he was an outsider, okay? And he said, okay, I asked people, and also he went to the library to look over the mathematics review, he told me. As we know, the capacity of Piero is incredible. Later on, he visited me also in the 80s, and first in Piero, he said that we don't collaborate. It made me very happy. But I knew that he and I has very common mathematical interest, but he has his own intuition and so on. So we are in a very desirable relationship, and I was very happy. But the thing that really stick to my mind, which has a vivid memory, is that he was teaching a course in linear algebra. And you know, Marion is a good state university, big one. So there are several sections of linear algebra. But you can choose your own book, and Piero choose the Gilbert strand. But it's a common syllabi, and that you everybody's supposed to cover that. You know, nobody really covered that. Everybody followed syllabi in a weak sense. But Piero said that this is a good syllabi, and he wants to follow it in a strong sense. You know, there's some danger to that, because the student is fishing around, okay? And they look at the fishing teacher, it's easier to get a good grade and so on. So if the enrollment go down to below 5 students, then the section will be closed, okay? However, it turns out that Piero actually has a very good attendance to the class. You know, his this insistence on the quality did it. And later on, after the semester over, my colleague would say, hey, your Italian friend, he's really good. Anyway, and so I have been always wondering, maybe some of you also, what makes Piero has this power of persuasion? And first, he has a vision. Okay, I now even after half of this conference, I feel even more deeply that this is the depth of Italian analysis. And then Piero just turned around and said that I'm going to do something else. Okay, so it's a very visionary, and that is exciting. Another thing, perhaps, is the insistence on the quality. And that brings trust, I would say. But there's another thing which is very difficult to quantify, but it's very real, and which is his sense of humanity. Piero has his heart with the underprivileged, and this surfaces up in our everyday conversation. But as Ugo said, Piero will express his way in his unique way, and so that makes it very comfortable. I guess this morning, Cedero also mentioned, it makes you feel comfortable. Happy birthday, Piero. Okay, so I want to talk about this singular layers. Now, in the study of Boltzmann equation, which is in the kinetic theory, there are two basic tasks. One is what the original intent of Boltzmann, namely, let's start from the first principle, Newtonian particle system, and try to derive all the way to fluid dynamics. But in between, he derives this Boltzmann equation. So from Newton to Boltzmann equation, this is one test for mathematical scientists. Another test is to go from Boltzmann to fluid dynamics. Is this second test that I want to talk about. And early on, Harold Grad, so he has this in 1963, he pointed out that if you want to study the relation between Boltzmann and fluid, you should pay attention to the singular layers. And there are these layers. I will come back to that. But as it turns out, in the actual natural physical setting, it is not only the singular layer that you want to know. It is the coupling of the singular layer. Let me go very quickly over this Boltzmann equation. Boltzmann equation is very hard. It's one equation. But if you know it, you know it. If you don't know it, my explanation will have little help, but let me try. So this equation has two parts. The left-hand side is the directional derivative. So you follow a particle and see what happened to your friend, whether someone joined you, and that would be F will increase, or someone departing you, F will decrease. And that is due to the left-hand side, which is the Q, and that is a collision. And collision is a binary, because we have this limit of a rarefied gas. Now, fluid dynamics, on the other hand, deal with the macroscopic variable, and that's a density, pressure, and so forth. Now, kinetic theory has one very immediate advantage, namely, it can give us a very natural definition of what a stress is, what is internal energy. In fact, before kinetic theory, internal energy was something put in there so that you have a second law of thermodynamics, and the first law of thermodynamics. But internal energy is given there as the randomness along around the mean velocity. And then there's a straight tensor and so on. The relation between the velocity before collision and after collision is given there. And this is given because you want to have a conservation mass, momentum, and energy to hold. And so it's come to this form. And because of that, you see that when we collect all the particles before and after collision, then nothing changed. So mass is conserved, and momentum is conserved, energy is conserved. So one can get this PD. But this PD is not determined PD. In Swiss space dimension, this is 5 PD, but there are more than 5 unknowns. If you look at the equation for this other unknowns, then you've got more unknowns. So Boltzmann equation is one equation, but it is equivalent to infinite number of PD. Now, of course, to solve a Boltzmann equation, and this is hard not only for our brain, but also for computer. And so it is important to simplify the Boltzmann equation by a finite dimensional PDE, and that is the what we call fluid dynamic. So you have this Boltzmann equation in kinetic theory. And then you want to go to fluid dynamic. Now, what the Boltzmann envision is that, well, we have fluid dynamic, which has been very successful in for the industrial revolution and so on. But he wants to go to the first principle to derive fluid dynamics. But as it so happened, there are new fluid dynamical phenomena that one can study using Boltzmann equation, but not with Navier Stokes or Euler. So let's say that one actually have a new kind of fluid dynamic coming out of the Boltzmann equation. Now, in this process, one needs to start a singular layer. So I try to explain that. The first important thing that the Boltzmann did, well, the conservation law, Maxwell had it. And Maxwell more or less said that, well, this atom and so on, we never saw it. And it's a fiction, but the conservation law is a real thing. So Maxwell did not really believe in Boltzmann equation. And the Boltzmann believed in atom. But the new thing that the Boltzmann did was that you multiply not the Boltzmann equation by one or cos or half cos squared. Instead, that multiply it by log. And then you get the inequality. In order for this inequality to become equality, and that will be a state we call the thermal equilibrium, then the distribution function will be Gaussian in Cc. Okay. And so this is called Maxwellian, but people also call it Maxwellian Boltzmann distribution because Maxwell has his great physical mind and he wrote down this, but Boltzmann justified it. So if the function, the distribution function is like a Maxwellian, is a Gaussian in Cc, if, then the conservation law becomes all the equation in gas dynamics. And then this is the five equation with the five unknown. So that's very good. However, the Boltzmann solution hardly ever stay on this equilibrium manifold. It go up and down this equilibrium manifold. So what we are saying is that if the solution is Maxwellian and Maxwellian depends on five parameter, so this is a five dimensional equilibrium manifold. If the distribution is on that manifold, then you have all the equation. And H theorem indicates that the general distribution will go toward that manifold. But if even if you have initial data, which is on that manifold, then you run the Boltzmann equation, then you'll be go away from that manifold. And so it is the motion around that manifold that where fluid dynamics phenomenon occur. And that is where you have a Hilbert expansion, Chapman Ansel expansion, and so on. But when the solution is getting close to equilibrium manifold, then the classical fluid dynamic would work. However, there are places where the distribution is far from, far away from this manifold, and that is called the singular layer. So there are three types of layers that I, actually there are more, but one is a boundary layer. So suppose you have a boundary here, and the gas will hit the boundary and deflect and so on. Out away from this boundary is very quickly due to collision become close to Maxwellian. But nearby here, it is not. And also the shock layer, which is the nonlinearity. and got a compression. And in that case, also this nonlinearity would drive the gas away from equilibrium, and that's the shock layer. And then there's the initial layer. I'll explain this with a specific example. So after Boltzmann equation is it's done, then people begin to study how fluid dynamics will come from the Boltzmann equation. And that's a study the classical problem using the Boltzmann equation. And the first one that I'll try is the Rayleigh's problem. So what the Rayleigh problem does is that if you have a wall here, say you have a solid, and you have a gas here, and this solid is moving with a speed, say V. So you have a solid is a move. And then the L, due to the boundary condition, and then the boundary condition is the usual one is called the diffuse reflection. The gas particle hit the boundary, and then it just go out randomly in every direction. So if you use this boundary condition, then what happened? Initially, the air will move along the boundary because the boundary itself is moving with the speed V over 2, or half of that speed. But gradually, the air will move along the boundary speed, the slip on the boundary will come to decay. And it decay at the rate T2 minus 1 half. Meantime, there's a interior wave that propagate toward the gas region. So this is what happened. However, this problem really is not solved even today. Cesignani has a solution of this problem. One is really interested in the behavior of the solution. And Yoshio Sonnen, using the Laplace transform, expansion, spatial function, and he managed to get that picture here. So the open problem is to understand this process. We do not know how it go from the first picture to the second one. And none of that is understood analytically. Okay, so this is an open problem. And this is the first problem people tried. And the solution is different from what prescribed by Navier-Stokes equation. And still we are open. So then we are in a very happy situation. So why this problem is hard? Well, because you set a goal high. You are interested in the solution behavior, and the solution changes quite a lot. Okay, so with Shi Xian Yu, we say, well, let's relax a little bit and build up some tool, and which is to control the green function. So green function, as we know, initial data is a delta function, and which means that you have ambient, which is the Maxwellian, and you have a bunch of particle, and you push it with speed C star. Then this bunch of particle is going to interact, collide with the ambient Maxwellian. And then what happened? That is what the green function tell us. Let me get a little bit of mathematical notation. First, green function, as any green function, is a linear notion. So you linearize the Boltzmann equation, and then the kernel of the linearized collision operator, L is a linear version of Q, and Q is zero on the five-dimensional manifold. So L has a kernel on the tangent space of this five-dimensional kernel. of the first dimension manifold. And H theorem suggests that we should have something called a macro-micro decomposition. One is orthogonal to one Maxwellian and two linearized, right? One particular one.
It's a global Maxwellian.
It's
with
a global
constant temperature.
Yes,
local Maxwellian.
No.
Okay.
So. Yes. This is a. As you call it M0, for example. Yeah. Okay, that's right. Yeah. And so the macro micro decompositions to find out the component of the function of KC, which is in the kernel or orthogonal to a kernel. Okay, and then if you do that, then you can use it to find the order characteristic, because the order equation live on this five-dimensional manifold. On the other hand, the collision operator for half sphere has been studied by Hilbert, and it looks like this. It has some singularity, but mostly a nice function. Or in any case, when these are used, one can construct a Green function. Now, the bottom equation, I mentioned earlier that it is equivalent to infinite number of PDE. So in that situation, spectrum theory to construct Green function is not sufficient. Okay, you never have a complete spectral information. So it takes some effort to come up with the structure of the Green function. I mean, that was done in 2004 and 2006 with Si Xianyu. Okay, so 1D Green function like that. First, you have a particle with a given velocity, KC star, you push it against this Maxwellian. This particle will stay as a particle, but decay due to the collision. Meantime, there will be fluid dynamic wave, which is the leading term, is given by Euler and Navier-Stokes. So if one have say three state dimension, then the particle wave will be more complicated. I just wrote down only one line, but it has this leading one and the other turn. And the fluid dynamic will have a Huygens wave and then thermal wave, vortex wave, and so on. Okay, so we have a explicit form of the leading term in the Green function, and the other form of Green function decay either faster or smoother. All right, so this is the tool we have. The example that I want to give is the Riemann problem for the order equation. Many people here know the Riemann problem is one constant state, another constant state. In this case, it's one Maxwellian, another Maxwellian. So now this is the initial layer, and it has a shock wave. So this is a coupling of initial and the shock layer. And this coupling gives rise to a rich phenomenon. So there are 5 layers. The very bottom one is called a kinetic layer. And the kinetic layer is hyperbolic. The scale is x over t. So you have a Maxwellian, which has a jump. And this jump creates a discontinuity in a microscopic velocity. And this layer has a width proportional to the mean free path, which I call the k. And then the interaction becomes to take a more serious effect. And then you get a second layer. And that layer is a parabolic scale. And this layer has a speed, has a width, is a mean free space times epsilon to the minus two. Epsilon is the strength of the shock. If the shock is very strong, then the nonlinearity quickly take over. And if the strength of the shock is weak, the nonlinearity take time to assert itself. Then there's a layer, and that layer, this paper is by Si Xian Yu, but this layer was understood in a paper with David Hall sometimes ago. It is how the nonlinearity form to become like a Boltzmann shock. And this takes some time from epsilon to the minus two to epsilon minus two times log epsilon. And after that, it is close to Boltzmann shock, and the stability of Boltzmann shock then take over, and that's the time asymptotic state. So this is a coupling of initial layer. There's an initial layer because initial data is a jump and it takes time to resolve that jump. But meantime, there's a shock wave there. So this interaction of these two singular layers. Just one more example, and that is the coupling of Knudsen type layer and fluid like wave. Now, Boltzmann equation, one of the important function of Boltzmann equation is to provide the boundary condition for the fluid equation. As we know, in every Navier-Stokes equation, you have a non-slippery boundary condition, Navier-type boundary condition. But how about if we start with the Boltzmann equation, and then what happened? So this is a study of Knudsen layer. But I'm focusing this example on the coupling of Knudsen type layer and the interior fluid-like wave. And I have this picture, which I will explain later on. Okay, so the Knudsen layer has been studied by many people, started in Russia and then the French really completed. So it is like that. You have you are given half of the distribution function because this is a stationary flow and it's hyperbolic. You only give information on the characteristics go into the region, and those is half of them. And then the Knudsen layer will have a width, which is proportional to the mean free path. So this is the Knudsen layer. However, there's a fluid wave, which sometimes come toward the Knudsen layer and couple with it. And in that case, the usual mathematical tool just break down. So what we do is the following. We will consider not just one Knudsen layer. We consider the collection of Knudsen layer. And this is a motivation from the dynamic system, the invariant manifold theory. And so we will try to use the Green function to construct that Knudsen layer and other combination. This page just to show you that there's a strong coupling, the nonlinear resonance. If the fluid wave, first the Knudsen layer doesn't move because I set the boundary to be here. But if the order characteristic is close to zero, then there's nonlinear coupling and the Knudsen layer and the fluid wave will form a wave pattern. And if one insists on looking at the only Knudsen layer, and as one get close to lambda 2 equals 0, for example, or lambda 1 equals 0, then the collision layer can be constructed only very, very small neighborhood of the Maxwellian. If you enlarge this Maxwellian and want to start a wave pattern, then it will not be this collision layer because the order wave will come to couple with the collision layer. And so this is what happened. The collision layer will couple with either compression wave or expansion wave. So this is a collection of things that Sushen and I started, and we worked hard for many years because first you had to have a green function which give us a sufficiently strong quantitative tool for this. Okay, now how do we do that? This is just one word about it. Use the green function, and then you come up with a boundary integral operator followed from the green identity, and you start this operator, given the understanding of the green function. So after all is done, we come up with this picture. So this picture, okay. So here, this two vertical one is basically what the H theorem tell us. If away from equilibrium manifold, you go down quickly, and then you got a collision there. However, if we call this, okay, Sonnet manifold, just in honor of Yoshio Sonnet of Kyoto University. This did that before us in the 80s and 90s. They did a very high quality computation and asymptotic expansion, and we provide the analytical understanding. So if you are here, for example, then there will be a collision there, which go quickly down as indicated by H theorem. However, as one get down here, then it becomes to slow down and become a compression wave, which we know from gas dynamic. Or you have a collision there, then followed by the expansion wave. Now here is a two Maxwellian, N minus and N plus. And this is a shock profile, the Boltzmann shock profile. By the way, we started the Boltzmann equation with try to prove positivity of Boltzmann shock. And at that time, we could not prove that the shock wave is a monotone. And this is a corollary shock wave is a monotone. Okay, so this is basically the story. Let me say that. Let me go back a little bit here. Okay, if you go from Mach number to be zero to one or to minus one, there's a bifurcation in between this. And okay, and this is a bifurcation picture. This picture is to tell us on which manifold you have a collision compression or collision and expansion or just collision and so on. So this is a picture which is taken from very two decades of hard work from Kyoto University. And we started this thing and finished in 2013. As I hope I give the impression that we have only scratched the surface. Study of singular layer is a crucial one. It provides you the boundary condition for the fluid equation, and away from this singular layer, then you ask which fluid dynamic equation you should use as a good approximation. And then it depends on Reynolds number, Mach number, and so on. So there's no one fluid dynamic equation. And there are fluid dynamic equations which is not stock, not never stock, not oil either. There's something called the thermal creep flow, which is modeled by the Boltzmann equation. So this is a huge field, and I tell you some instance of it. Thank you.
It's time for questions.
So the same method can work if you have more or less a hydrodynamic shock move to the boundary, and then you have the boundary interaction with the shocks. Can you do the similar things? You have a Ludens in the air interact with the let's say a shock which you know collects two Maxwellian. Is that a possible?
Really, the only time one can start stability and the dynamic behavior is the initial shock is one shock. And this chair, the one have here, is a stable one, stationary. Mm-hmm. Of course, you can argue the stationary. One tell you the whole story in some sense, but really one would like to study the stability and so on. And that is open.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Something very vague in the sense that you said that I want to go to the first principle to explain fluid dynamics. But Boltzmann is only for rarefied gas. So it's a special kind of fluid dynamics, fluid dynamical behavior.
Sure,
what
sure,
you
sure.
think for
yeah,
more,
yeah, sure, sure,
for
sure.
more realistic
fluids,
what one could
right,
do?
Right. Sure, sure. I mean, you would not ever go to van der Waal gas, for example. Like Boltzmann would not, So that's true, yeah. But with the modern technology, of going smaller and smaller scale, a Boltzmann equation is there to stay. Yeah, but you are quite right, absolutely. Yeah, you will not go, if your gas were dense, then you have phase transition, van der Waal gas and so on, and this doesn't address that. Yeah.
Other questions? Just let me ask something which is a curiosity, because aeronautical engineers usually, when they do their simulation, they have somehow a mixing of Boltzmann approach and the fluid dynamic approach. They have a sort of a Boltzmann layer around.
Yes.
How this related with this analysis? Somehow there could be a point of a contact to interpret this Boltzmann layer there.
This is a hard question. let me first, I don't know how to answer your question, but let me go to this picture. Now, if you do numerical simulation, you don't really want to study the Boltzmann equation, particularly near the boundary. This is very hard. That's what even the Kyoto school, they do it with the BGK model. They don't do it with the Boltzmann equation. Yeah. And so what a picture like this shows is that you narrow down to this particular case. And after that, then you provide a boundary condition for the fluid dynamic equation. I shouldn't say that the boundary condition for the fluid dynamic equation, not this give you a boundary condition. No, you have to do both, right? They are coupled. And then fluid dynamic equation, it depends on, I try to say, Mach number, Reynolds number, and so on. And so you could be stock equation, linear order equation, or never stock, or something more. And so I guess that would be the reasonable thinking. Yeah.
Thank you. So further questions? Okay, it's people is really now time to go to eat. And maybe you have some announcement for this evening. So